Welcome to Wim Turkenburg of Utrecht University, or former Utrecht University. What should I say, actually?
Still Utrecht University.
Okay.
I'm professor at Utrecht University, and my background is in atomic and molecular physics.
Right. But then again, you're a well-known critic or commentator on nuclear issues. For instance, we saw you a lot on TV in connection to the Fukushima accident, etc.
Yeah.
So you're always a willing commentator.
Well, it's an important item, not only on nuclear, but on the whole energy scene. So I was also involved in what's called the Global Energy Assessment that was published last year. It was an exercise of about 5 years by about 300 scientists from all over the world, also deeply criticized, internally reviewed.
Mm-hmm.
And that was focusing on one of the items that is a major item in this movie, not only nuclear, but also climate change.
Yes.
So I will give comments on that later on as well.
Okay, great.
On the other hand, I must say, in the nuclear field, I'm also involved in, let's say, studies related to the Borssele nuclear reactor.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm a member of the safety committee, you could say, in controlling what they are doing there. And I'm also involved in producing medicines from nuclear technology.
Yes. Okay. So you're not a stranger to the field.
I'm not.
Well, of course, you're not. Otherwise, you wouldn't be here.
I have a background of about 40 years in nuclear.
Right, right. Well, we watch your film, of course, as an audience. There were some laughs and smirks at some points, but we'll get to those, I guess. But first of all, I'd like to hear from Wim Turkenburg your first impressions of this film. Its message, and perhaps what it's not saying. Could you give us a first reaction, please?
I want to make four major points.
Okay.
Of course, I have a lot of items to be discussed.
Well, four sufficient.
But let me start with saying that it is a well-made movie, and it's addressing a point that is well-made, and that's the issue of people having a position, a stand, with not enough knowledge, deep knowledge, and I agree on that.
Mm-hmm.
On the same time, I'm saying that's on both sides.
Okay.
So I made a list of about at least 20 items, mistakes that were made in the movie, statements
that were
he will say it's not true, but that were mistakes made in this movie, statements that were made. I can give a lot of examples. People now being in favor, in the past being against it. So that's one point.
Okay.
Another point is the issue of climate change. The statement is made, and I'm very much concerned about climate change. Probably we have in common that item. I think it's one of the most important environmental issues that we have to solve. The message is in this movie that we need nuclear to solve it. And I was making a reference to the Global Energy Assessment that we published last year. And one of the conclusions is that that's not true. Of course, it can be part of the solution,
mm-hmm.
but it's not a need. So if we would really focus on energy savings, on renewables, and also on a cleaner use of fossil fuels, for example, with carbon capture and storage, then there is not a need to use nuclear. So I would like to make that point as well.
Okay.
So that is also part of the criticism that I have. And another point is, I agree with what is said, that you can develop new technologies in the nuclear field that are far more safer than the present technology. And the reference was made to the integrated fast reactor. There are other types that are developed as well, but we also must then confess that it will take at least 30 years from now before these technologies can be, let's say, realized in practice. Within the 30 years, we have to solve the climate issue. So I'm very much in favor of doing research in that area, inherently safe reactors, and meanwhile also much better attacking the waste problem and also the proliferation issue. I think that's one of the major issues. It was hardly addressed my five view, not enough addressed the proliferation of nuclear weapons. Think about Iran that we are reading in the newspapers each day. Mm-hmm. That is heavily connected with the peaceful use of nuclear energy.
Okay.
So that's something that was point four.
Okay. Proliferation. That's
proliferation. Yeah.
Okay. Robert Stone. You started nodding no about these.
Yeah, I mean, when somebody says there are 20 factual errors in the film without telling me what they are, this film has been out.
Oh, we can't get into a list of.
Well, I don't want to go through lists because I mean we should have that conversation. You know, it's too long a list. But this film has been gone over by an army of scientists, including my senior science advisor, Nobel Prize winning physicist Dr. Burton Richter, and a number of others. And has been under a microscope by anti-nuclear groups since it was released at the Sundance Film Festival in January.
Okay, it's still.
And you're the first person to say there's 20 factual.
It might be instructive to have just one or two.
Yeah. Well, I'm not the only person. If you look in the literature, for example, of the Union of Concerned Scientists,
which is a notorious anti-nuclear activist group.
No, that's not. It's a critical group in the field of nuclear energy. Not per se against nuclear. Well, for example, one issue is the number of deaths related to Chernobyl. Reference is made to what is claimed in the movie, scientific publications of the UN, and I know these publications. We have made a review of that for the Global Energy Assessment. And our statement in the Global Energy Assessment, with a lot of scientists behind it, also from the UN, is that probably the number of deaths related to this Chernobyl is something like between 10 and 20,000 people.
In the statement in this movie is
that it's just 50.
Just a second. Let me talk. Just a second here.
Okay.
Just a second.
Your reply, please.
I am not saying anything. I am not an expert.
No. I'm not saying that you are saying it. You're using a person that is saying it.
The film is not making a statement. The film and the people behind the film and me have not gone and done independent studies. We have not gone to Chernobyl and done epidemiological studies and sent hundreds of scientists out into the field. The only people who have done that on that level, on that scale, is the World Health Organization, about a half a dozen UN agencies. You're about to talk again. Let me finish. Let me just finish. They've put this information out there. They did the first report in 2005. It's incredibly counterintuitive, I agree, a surprise to me as much as anyone. But being counterintuitive does not make it false. Now, it's been peer-reviewed. It's been updated regularly. It's been signed off on by half a dozen UN agencies who conducted the survey, signed off on by the governments of Ukraine, Belarus, and Russia, the most affected areas, which is a big deal for them to do that. And it is considered within the scientific community the gold standard body of research on that topic. And this is what they say. Those who discount it have put forth the idea that the World Health Organization and the United Nations is perpetrating a cover-up and a conspiracy because they're in cahoots with the nuclear industry or something. It's just preposterous. And it's the same argument that's made by people who just can't tolerate the IPCC report on climate change, that the United Nations is somehow, because they put out information, a scientific study that contradicts their beliefs, that there's some sort of cover-up and conspiracy. So all you're doing when you make the claim that it's 10,000, 25,000, the Union of Concerned Scientists, I don't know what their number, Greenpeace a few years ago said 650,000, now they're back to 90,000, Colin Caldwell said it's a million. All you're doing is using the linear no threshold theory that you know about and expanding the pool of people to include, say, all of Europe or all of the world, and you just keep ratcheting up the number.
Let's step back for a second.
But it's an important point.
Let's step back. You as a documentary maker.
Right.
You're saying we're not taking a stand. Is that correct? You're just looking at people making a stand?
No, I'm making a stand.
Okay,
absolutely.
What's your stand?
My stand is I have come to the conviction that there is no feasible path to solving a climate crisis within the time frame that the climate scientists tell us we have left without nuclear power. So whether you're pro-nuclear or anti-nuclear, and I've been spending most of my life being anti-nuclear, what we need to do, if you're anti-nuclear, let's make nuclear power better. Not no nukes, better nukes.
Okay.
But I mean, just 2-3 weeks ago, the world's leading climate scientists, including Dr. James Hansen, who first brought climate change to the world's attention 25 years ago, wrote an open letter to the world's environmental movement pleading with them to support the development and deployment of advanced nuclear power.
Okay.
Because they're convinced that there is no credible path forward.
Hansen is one of the most well-known critics of coal, of course.
Absolutely, he is.
So he's taking nukes for coal? Is that what he's doing?
You can't. We are not right now. I mean, we are right now adding to the world the energy equivalent of adding another Brazil to the planet every year.
Mm-hmm.
Coal, despite all of our efforts with renewable energy, which has been considerable, is still not only the most ubiquitous source of energy, it's the fastest growing source of energy. Climate, the CO2 emissions are going through the roof at an accelerating rate. So your calm, assurances that we can just stick with the program that you've advocated for 25 years and everything's going to be great, just doesn't bear fruit.
We need a reaction from Wim Turkenburg on the necessity of nuclear energy.
Exactly, that's what I indicated. I agree that unabated nuclear power is not a solution for the near future, not at all. So if we are going further with coal, it should be abated. So we have to combine it with carbon capture and storage. So that can be also part of the solution then. And of course, I know that there are other items as well to be discussed with coal. But the statement that you are making that we need nuclear to solve the climate change issue, my reaction is, it was my impression that that was true. Till we did the global energy assessment, so my expectation, I was one of the initiators of that study, my expectation was the outcome will probably be we need nuclear, and the outcome was, it's people from EASA and from IAEA involved, the Atomic Energy Agency, that's not the case. It can be part, but it is not a need, it's not a necessity.
What energy sources would then be in place of these nuclear plants?
We are giving a lot of energy routes to the future, to the year 2050. Mm-hmm. And for example, with less and more energy savings, and with less and more renewables, and the renewables that's in the range between 30 and 75% globally.
Yeah.
And the other part is then coming from fossil fuels and or nuclear. And if you don't want to have nuclear, then you have to combine fossil fuels, at least to a large extent, with CCS.
Okay.
It's carbon capture and storage.
Robert Stone, let's turn it around. Why not focus on the renewable energy sources?
I think we should. I think we need everything. I'm not against wind and solar. I think we need absolutely everything.
Okay.
And probably things that we haven't even thought of. But we've got a very... I think one of the problems that... those who are most concerned about climate change have had is that they've mistaken the ends with the means. So the ends have become, let's do more wind and solar. Mm-hmm. That's a policy goal that one should advocate for without looking at, well, these are actually just tools to solve a problem. And so what struck me with the people I found it to make this film about is they kind of stepped back from that. It's called, Michael uses this term, energy tribalism. To step back and what is it that we're trying to solve? We're mm-hmm. trying to get us off of fossil fuels because fossil fuels are having a horribly detrimental impact on the world's ecosystem, and it's going to get worse and worse and worse.
Making this film, was this before or after Fukushima?
I was at Fukushima, happened in the middle of it.
What was your first thought at that moment?
Well, I mean, I think for a couple of hours there, it was like, oh shit. And then it was like, oh my God, the entire world is talking about the subject I'm making a film about. And there's not a single filmmaker in the entire planet who will dare to continue to make the film that I'm making. And I got lots of calls.
Wasn't there any doubts at that moment? Because this was something going very wrong.
Absolutely.
Exactly in the technology you were
absolutely
in favor of.
But if you step back of it, the reason that I set out to make this film in the first place, it was still the same. And so even whatever happened, as I say, we need to make nuclear power better. We need to make it safer. We need to make it cheaper.
Mm-hmm.
We need to make it better, quicker, all of these things. And that doesn't change You know, if the lesson from Fukushima is let's shut down every nuclear power plant in the world, and
the Germans
just go
did.
They did, and they're building more coal plants, mm-hmm. and their CO2 emissions are going up. But let's do that. Then, you know, the result is going to be more fossil fuels, and that's what I'm against. That's my goal in life is to stop that from happening.
Wim Turkenberg, you mentioned new technology, safer, etc. Okay, but it takes time. It takes too much time. Is that what you said?
It can, it's still worthwhile to develop it, but mm-hmm. it takes indeed too much time. If you are thinking about 20 years from now, maybe we can use the fourth generation new nuclear power plants before that period within the coming 30 years, we have to solve it. So if you then are choosing for nuclear, that means you go ahead with the present technology.
Right.
And also with all the, let's say, the negative point associated with that. And I agree that a lot of misinformation has been distributed, especially by what was your name, Calicut, mm-hmm. Helga, I don't know her name exactly.
The woman with the literature.
The woman, yeah, exactly. Yes. So, but that is, I am thinking you're making a little bit a caricature of people that are against nuclear, but by taking the person that is, let's say, very much emotional and extreme also in the facts, mm-hmm. and not solid at all. But you can have people with solid opinions, right. and solid facts that are also not in favor of nuclear.
But I did not set out with this film to document the debate.
I agree.
I set out to start a debate and to jump headfirst into that debate, because it's a debate that we environmentalists have not been having. Nuclear power has not been discussed, and I think it's the fact that we're even having this conversation, I think, is a very healthy thing.
Okay, I think very significant in what you said is we environmentalists.
Yeah, that's I've been environmentalists my whole life.
And I agree on that. We have to discuss it. I agree on that.
Right. Okay. We can. Actually, you're here to join the discussion, of course. We have some hands. We need to get the mic somewhere. That's near the hat.
Maybe I'm clear enough.
Okay. Well, no, we're not, because we're on camera and we can't hear you.
Okay.
This will be used forever.
On the web for eternity. Everything you say.
I have seen in this movie the closing of the plant in the United States. Why, as a question on the professor, why is the Kalkar project now Disneyland?
Well, in fact, the Kalkar project in Germany, but Netherlands was involved together with Belgium in building that. That was a fast breeder reactor, like the one, more or less the one like propagated in the movie. Although in the movie, that was much safer. That was the integrated fast reactor. That is even a better one than in Kalkar. So the outcome was that breeder reactors are far more expensive than normal reactors, light water reactors. So the cost of electricity produced by the Kalkar reactor would be 2 or 3 times higher than the cost from a light water reactor. And we started building this reactor thinking about a huge expansion of the development of nuclear. Then we would run out of uranium resources, normal uranium resources, the uranium-235. So then we need also the other part of uranium, and that is uranium-238. And you can convert that to plutonium. That is also done in the integrated fast reactor. And then you have a huge amount of uranium available for the longer term.
It was meant to breed fuel.
It was meant to breed fuel, such that you create more fuel than you are using. And then you can, let's say, for hundreds of years, maybe 1,000 years, continue this using nuclear power. But then all of a sudden, after the accident in Harrisburg, the Three Mile Islands accident, and the drop in the expansion of nuclear fuel, it was another picture of the world. There was not running out. We were not running out of uranium resources. The Kalkar reactor was far too expensive, so then it was turned down, also because of all kinds of questions about safety issues related to this
and
type
this, of this technology. This Disneyland part, you mean, is it safe, or is that not, is that what you meant?
No, my question was, there is put so much money in this project.
Yes, that's true.
Mm-hmm. Well, it was shut down for, you're talking about the German, it was shut down for political reasons, right?
What?
It was shut down for largely political reasons. It was a test reactor.
I wouldn't say that, but
it was an experimental reactor.
It was a 300 megawatt electric reactor, so it's not a huge one yet. It's for demonstration certainly, but also for commercial use. And I would not say it's for political reasons only that it was turned down. It was also commercially. The energy companies were not really interested anymore. And so the Nuance and the Essenten and so on. The RWE's were not really interested in this type of technology. They're also not really interested in the integrated fast reactor. So that's certainly a problem if you want to develop this new technology as you are propagating more or less in your movie. They are not interested.
Who's not interested?
The energy companies like RWE, the electricity companies.
Right. Well, they're not interested in carbon capture and storage because it raises the cost of fossil fuels. And they're not interested in wind and solar unless they're subsidized.
They seem to be interested
at
all.
Whenever you pull the subsidies away from wind and solar, they collapse. So this is a problem for all technologies.
I know.
Okay. Another question. Perhaps to Stone.
Thank you. Yeah, this is about the film, really, rather than about having the debate. I think it's very useful to have a debate and a discussion. Let me just say, to start, by professional background, I'm a radiation technologist, and I'm also anti-nuclear. So coming to this film, I was very much looking forward to having some boundaries extended and having some new areas for debate. So it's about the choices, really, that you made in the film, in which you showed us that there's a group of people who were previously ill-informed about nuclear power who've changed their minds. You've showed us that, you told us that nuclear power perhaps not as bad as some people thought. You've told us climate change is a real problem and coal is an enormous part of that. You've showed us that Helen Caldicott is a little bit mad. And you've showed us that you've suggested that if more money is put into nuclear power, things might get better. But none of that is really new. And some of the things that were not explored in the film were any reasonable portrayal of a different view than the folks you chose. Or discussion of things like the economics or the time frame for implementation of nuclear. Mm-hmm. And certainly no justice was done to the possible alternatives. So I wonder why you made those choices in order to have the discussion, which is what you say your purpose was.
Right. Thank you. As a filmmaker, I can influence public opinion and start a debate. I cannot influence the cost. I could talk about the cost, but the cost, those are projections into the future of how do we make, I think once we're having the discussion of how do we make this cheap, then we're having a rational discussion. And until now, most environmentalists, I mean, maybe you've been having a rational discussion, but the leadership of most environmental groups have not been having a reasonable discussion about this. And if you want the proof of that, they threw all of their top leaders at me to debate me on CNN a couple weeks ago when it was broadcast on CNN. And if you want to see reasonable discussion from the environmental leadership, take a look. The cost thing, we're not going to bring the cost down until we start mass producing these things, that's, you know, as long as we're building one behemoth nuclear power plant after another, one at a time, they're going to be very expensive. Although they do pay themselves off in the long run, but not within the strictures of a capitalist unregulated energy market. The United States nuclear generated electricity is the cheapest electricity we have. Gas has just, I think, tipped the scales recently on that. But it's because the plants are all paid off and they last for 80 years.
Getting back to the question to the filmmaker, didn't you put those into your movie?
Because it's not something that I can really influence. I've got 90 minutes to tell a story. The economics is kind of a wonky debate that I think needs to be had. But my purpose as a filmmaker was get us to have, you know, policy people and people who are concerned about this to start have that debate. But if this is something we want to pursue as a society and get behind, okay, well then it's up to business and policymakers to make it cheaper.
So that'll be Pandora's box too,
nah,
isn't
maybe
it?
That. But there was the second part of your question was, I'm sorry, I missed it. I was in my head and I forgot.
Could you yell it?
Just remind me what the other major point you make.
More attention for renewables, for example.
Oh, renewables. Yeah, yeah. Yes. No, that's important. I'm not, look.
You're only showing turbines standing still, for
instance. Didn't look for that, actually. I went out three times to film turbines, and that's what happened.
There's lots of footage of them turning,
isn't it?
There's
lots of footage. Isn't that interesting that you only ever see them spinning in the movies? But in fact,
for real, they do as well. But not always. Take a ride in Holland, you'll see.
But not always. But the point is, I think what you're advocating actually is extremely dangerous. It's a dangerous delusion. It's a dangerous delusion to imagine that this energy source that provides an infinitesimal amount of energy to the world's power grid to this day, let alone primary energy, it's way below 1%. Okay, and we've been at this for 25 years, that your position is stay the course, where somehow energy efficiency is going to reduce overall energy demand, and somehow renewables are going to replace fossil fuels. We've heard that for 25 years, my point.
Well, I'd like to invite you to take note of this global energy assessment. It's a huge volume, but you can just read the summary giving, the answers to these kind of questions. It's not an easy solution just focusing on the renewables. I completely agree on that. And that you need backup power, that's certainly an issue if you want to focus especially on wind and on solar, like solar cells. And that is certainly an item that I'm addressing in the Netherlands heavily at the moment.
Yes.
Because we are running into problems within the coming years already because of what's going on in Germany in this field.
So I agree that this is an important solution,
but it's not unsolvable.
Okay. Final question here. We're running out of time.
Wow, that went so fast.
Yeah, well, let's find a bar and continue, okay? Final question.
Claude Biemans, I'm a physicist myself, and a few years ago I did a study on nuclear possibilities, and one of the conclusions was that it's really even hard to keep up building new nuclear centers because all of the 70s ones are outdated and they have to close down, and it's really hard to keep the pace of building these nuclear centers to keep the level. And I really want to know, do you think that we have the choice between every energy options? Can we really choose not to use nuclear?
Who are you asking?
Yeah.
Wim Tuckenberg?
Both of them.
Okay.
Well, do you think there is an option to choose? Because we want these developing countries to have energy as plenty as we have.
Wim Tuckenberg?
Well, it's certainly the situation that if you are developing all energy sources that we have, that you have a higher chance that you can fulfill all the energy needs and solve the climate issue. So that's, I agree on that. If that is a statement made by Robert, then I agree. My statement on the other hand is it is not necessary. I indicated that was the outcome of the study. We need energy savings, we need renewables, we need also CCS, also to achieve what is called negative emissions on the longer term. If you combine CCS with biomass,
CCS being use, carbon capture and storage,
combined with biomass use, to get negative emissions, then you can draw out CO2 from the atmosphere. And it would help if you would use nuclear, but it has to fulfill, let's say, sustainability criteria. And what are then the sustainability criteria? We have formulated them, for example, for biomass, but what are these criteria for nuclear? And I would say they should be inherently safe. Present reactors are not inherently safe. We should have nuclear waste that have a much shorter lifetime. It can be reduced, and the integrated fast reactor can be part of that solution. Right. But as I indicated, it takes at least 30 years before it is commercial. And we have heavily to solve the proliferation issue. And that's the major danger, in my view, connected with nuclear power, peaceful nuclear power.
Final answer from Robert. Do we have the luxury to choose?
Well, no. Obviously, I wouldn't have made the film without it. But look, in terms of can we do this? France went from 100% fossil fuels for electricity generation to 80% nuclear in 20 years using 1970s era light water reactors. So they proved the case that it can be done within the time frame that climate scientists tell us we have left. If we start going into mass production, I think with advanced reactor designs we could certainly speed that up. So it can be done. I don't think there's a choice. I know there's these academic studies that do provide a technical feasibility of how you can do it without nuclear, but why would you, you know, we do live in a political world. We do live in reality where there are limited resources. Countries are not going to voluntarily raise their energy prices and rebuild their entire electric grids for no apparent reason. So we have to work with reality, and sometimes these academic studies divorce themselves from reality and imagine, well, if we had unlimited funds and if we had unlimited political,
I don't think
could
these
we technically
studies are
do these
those
things?
Kinds of studies.
And I think that's, well,
I know Wim.
I haven't read yours, but I've read a number of them.
Okay, let's leave it to this. There's plenty of room in this giant casino to, no casino, no, what's it called?
We're in a casino?
No, we're not.
Damn.
Okay, we're not. But still, we have plenty of time to talk if we like to. I was wondering, you as an audience, were you convinced? Who was thinking nuclear sucks when he entered and is now turned around? No one. who thought the sucks part? Okay, the rest was in favor? Yeah, really?
Wow.
And you still are. You brought your own audience.
This is a mystery. This has never happened before.
Okay, this is really a mystery.
No, usually. It's okay. Interesting. Usually
thank
the audience is
thank you for taking part in the discussions, and especially thank you, Robert Stone and Wim Turkenberg.
Thank you.